Hey, everybody. Kris White with the American Battlefield Trust. I'm here with Doug Ullman. We're on Coster Avenue here in Gettysburg, and we're gearing up for the Remembrance Day Parade here in 2022. And Doug's going to show us some of his kit as he gets ready to head up to the parade. We're going to cover that parade on YouTube today at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And there are two different remembrances today. There's Remembrance Day Parade, that's run by the Sons of Union Veterans, and then we have what is called Dedication Day, and that is the dedication of the Gettysburg's National Cemetery, the Soldiers' National Cemetery, when Abraham Lincoln, President Abraham Lincoln, gave his famous Gettysburg Address. But we have Evan Portman behind the camera, Sarah K. Byerly back there coaching him along, and we have Doug Ullman over here showing us his kit, showing as a Union soldier, a Northern soldier, a Yankee soldier. Doug, what do we have going on here? And is this everything you're carrying for the parade today?
Well, in short, no, because I'm not marching in the parade. Number two, if you were going to march in a parade or in a review, like you think of the Grand Review or any of those dress parades that would happen for inspection, you would not march out with all of your stuff. That being said, what I have here is the entirety of what a Civil War soldier might carry on a campaign. And that's kind of how I've geared my impression, is to try and lean it down towards what a soldier would carry on campaign, marching, let's say, from the banks of the Rappahannock River across the Potomac and into Pennsylvania. So what I have here is, it variously falls into personal items and military items. The military items are the things that you see right in front here. I have my cartridge box where I carry my ammunition, 40 rounds of ammunition are going to fit inside of this leather case that's called a cartridge box. The ammunition would be stored in these tins, where you would see 10 rounds here, 10 rounds there, two tins, that's 40 rounds of ammunition, and then any tools or other equipment that you might need. If you need a wrench to open up your weapon for extended cleaning, you have that as well. That is going to be the cartridge box, the ammunition pouch of the Civil War soldier. Next, we have the belt and bayonet with scabbard and the cap box. The cap box is important because in here are the percussion caps that are going to ignite the powder that is going to fire the bullet. Without the percussion caps, there is no firing of the rifle musket. So these are very essential. They are kept in a, you see there are two lids on this cap box that is to keep moisture out of it as much as possible. And I'm not going to lose that either because we don't want someone thinking there was a relic out here. And then of course, the bayonet, the three-sided bayonet. I've heard that these bayonets of this kind are now illegal, or they're against the rules of war, because the wounds that they create are three-sided, means they don't heal very well, and often you'd see soldiers, they would be told to bury it and then twist it to make that wound even more nasty. But this is the bayonet that goes to the rifle musket, which is right over here. This is an 1863, right? This is an 1861 Springfield rifle musket. This is a reproduction, but very similar to the original in most respects. And those three items, the musket, the belt and cap box and bayonet, and the cartridge box, those are the three military items that we're most concerned with. The soldier must have those on at all times, especially if they're on duty on picket. Think of this, when you hear about soldiers going out to guard the army or out as pickets in defense of the army, they're going to be wearing these things. They will even be told to sleep with these things on. If you ever read about a soldier being told to sleep on their arms, they mean you're going to sleep with your rifle cradled next to you, wearing your ammunition box and your cap box, so that if you were called upon to fight in a moment's notice, you could just hop out of the grass and start fighting. So that's what it means to sleep on your arms. Everything else is personal items, or things for the soldier's personal life. So we have this essential piece of equipment is the canteen. Canteen covered in this jean cloth or wool to help keep the moisture, help keep the water cool. You'd be surprised at how cool this will actually stay during hot summer days with just this jean cloth covering on it. We also have the haversack, that is this black bag here. And this is where the soldier's going to keep personal items such as food. So I've got a canteen half that I use as a plate, an old piece of hardtack. I don't know how old that is, but I made it myself. And then some eating utensils with a towel. And then my cup, which is going to be used for not only coffee or water, sometimes some other beverages, as well as cooking. You cook in this as well. It's a very good conductor of heat. And today it's also protecting my keys and wallet as I wear this stuff around. I also, for me, I also keep other personal items in my haversack, things that other people might put in their knapsack. I'm gonna keep in my haversack because I want them when I can get them. So I've got a journal that I would write in if I were a soldier, and I keep my copy of the New Testament on me when I'm on the march so that I have access to those things. Because you're not going to have time to unpack your entire knapsack to get to these personal items if you're stopped on the side of the road for a halt. If you want to be able to read or write, you're gonna need to keep that stuff pretty handy. Speaking of personal items, here is the reproduction wallet that I carry with me at events. I also have a photograph of myself and my wife that I keep in that wallet, and I keep that in my breast pocket in my coat at all times, as well as a handkerchief, especially on hot days or cold days like this one. It's always good to have that handy. I keep that on my person. Then we have the soldiers' house items, things that they're going to need for camp life. So I have a ground cloth, a rubber ground cloth, or it's a piece of cloth that is covered in a rubber, what is it? They call it a gum blanket. What's the actual, do you know the actual scientific name for this stuff?
I always seen it as an India gum blanket.
Right.
But that's about as scientific as I get.
Yeah, it feels very much like you would expect rubber to feel, and it shouldn't surprise us that this was a pattern made by the BF Goodyear company. So the company that we think of as tires today that was around in some form or fashion as early as the 1850s. And so we have this gum blanket. This is a highly prized item for soldiers. You can put this on the ground to keep the ground water from getting up to you as you're sleeping, or put it over things to protect them from the rain. Better to sleep in the mud and keep yourself covered from the rain sometimes. And then in here I have also my blanket. It's a very heavy wool blanket. I'm not going to unfold it, but I keep that in here in my knapsack, which you'll see in just a minute. Then I have other personal items. I have an extra pair of socks. I have another shirt. I'm wearing two shirts under my blouse right now. So these are just extra clothing items that I might want or need on a summer campaign. I might just keep this shirt and one other and ditch my heavy flannel shirt that I'm wearing underneath. Some soldiers may not have carried this, but I keep a lantern in my pocket, in my knapsack as well, with a candle. And then personal hygiene. We have here one of my favorite items in my kit. This is my housewife or sewing kit. It was actually made for me by my mother, in which you can keep extra buttons, needle and thread, to repair things on your uniform. And I've actually used this housewife a number of times to repair things that I'm wearing right now, including replacing some of the buttons on this shirt. And then we have some hygiene items. I have some soap in here, a toothbrush, and a comb, another Goodyear pattern comb that I would keep in a small little ditty bag that would then go into my knapsack. And all of those things are the things that the common soldier would need or might want to have when they're on campaign, marching, fighting, things that was going to keep them fighting well, keep them fed, and then keep them protected from the elements. That's what we got here.
So, Doug, thanks. You're with the American Battlefield Trust. Please share this with your friends and your family. This is a great opportunity to learn more about the life of the common soldier. So let's talk just a few minutes about a couple of the items here. We have our shelter half.
Oh, yes.
That's under here. So this is very important for our soldiers. Doug, what's a shelter half?
Shelter half is pretty much what it sounds like. It's half a shelter, so half a tent. Every Civil War soldier was issued half of a tent, and he would partner up with a buddy, and then they would button those two halves together to create a whole tent. So if you ever go to these reenacting camps, you see these shelter halves put together, you should see two men sleeping in each of those under one tent. They each get a half, and then they will combine them to make one tent, and then two men sleep under that tent. So I carry one half of a shelter, and I'm fully prepared to sleep under one half of a shelter and just pretend that it's, because I got nobody.
Well, we also call these dog tents or pup tents. And Doug can put up his shelter half. We call that a shebang. That's a nickname for it, where you basically put up a what looks like a half of a tent up And then you'll use sticks to put those up. There's ropes here that'll help to go
and
around the stakes.
I've got some stakes in there wrapped up, I just didn't unwrap them all.
And not the stakes that you're thinking of from like Ponderosa or other places like that. We're talking about the metal ones that go into the ground.
And into vampires.
And vampires. Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter is a great movie. We have his wool blanket. This is always very important. And when you're out in the cold like this, one of the things the soldiers would do is put their wool blanket over top of them and take their poncho, if they have a poncho, which is exactly like their gum blanket that goes on the ground to keep the ground moisture away from you as best as possible. But the poncho is just that gum blanket with a slice in the middle of it, so you could put it over your head just like wearing a poncho. You would put that over top of you. That'll help you keep a little bit more warm, a little more insulated. Doug pointed out his 1861 Springfield musket that we have here. The 61 Springfield, we know it is because on the lock plate, it'll tell us it's 1861. But importantly, down here on the breech of the gun, we have our cone. This cone over here actually has a screw in the side of it. This side screw will let us clean out the vent area here that'll go down into the back of the gun, which takes the flame from that percussion cap and goes down into the breech, goes into the gunpowder, which will then have a chain reaction, which will then send the bullet down range. So for an 1861, we have a screw here. For the 1863 Springfield, which is a little bit lighter, they don't have a screw over here. They'll have a stamp, maybe an eagle on the side of it. You see his elevated sights that he has here. We can reach out and touch someone at 1,000 yards, but they usually don't do that. 300 yards and in is usually whenever they start to fire at people, so you can flip up your 300-yard sight there. But the average Civil War combat is about 127 yards distance. That's when they would start to fire at one another. You could aim and fire 3 shots a minute. Doug also pointed out his bayonet. That's a socket bayonet that would go over the end of the gun or the muzzle of the gun, and like a socket goes over top of it, it locks in. And when it locks in, that means Doug can still load and fire his musket. Prior to this, he would have had a plug bayonet, where it's just basically making your gun into a big spear. And this one, Doug can still actually load and fire. And a trained soldier can fire 3 shots per minute, aim shots per minute. So Doug, I think the million-dollar question we have over here is, you have all this equipment. We have tarred haversack that'll help keep the moisture out. We have our blankets, we have all this stuff, we have our gun, 60 rounds of ammunition. How long does it take to put this on?
Let's find out.
All right, we're gonna time Doug to see how long it's gonna take your average soldier to try to put together his kit. So let me pull up my stopwatch.
Now before we start the timer, I will concede that I've left a few things partially done. I did not unfold my blanket, and I didn't completely unroll my my shelter half. Now that being said, you'll read about a lot of soldiers who will just be told to sleep out on the side of the road. So I really question sometimes how much they would have time to put up shelter halves, or even if in seasonable weather would even bother to take out their blanket. That's up for individual debate. And it's also a good disclaimer. You know, this is my kit that I've assembled over years, over what I think from my research is how a Civil War soldier would live. Soldiers today don't do the same things as one another, and so there's no reason to think that this is exactly how a Civil War soldier would have done things, or that every Civil War soldier would have carried all of this stuff. But looking at it from the perspective of what does a man need, what does a person need when they are on campaign, these are the things that I've collected, and this is how I'm going to put my kit together.
All right, Doug. It is just about go time. And one thing I want to point out, too, that Doug has a soft-sided backpack. It's a two-sided backpack, in fact, where you can put stuff in both sides of it. But there are other types of backpacks you would see. Some of them are more comfortable. Some are less comfortable. Some actually have wood inside of them, a wood frame. Those are usually the early war ones. So what you're seeing here is a really cool kit. And I forgot to point out, Doug, what are you wearing?
Oh, yeah, well, so I kind of ignored that. I'm wearing the standard fatigue uniform of the United States Army in 1861. This is the fatigue blouse that is a 4-button, what you can often call a sack coat. This is a contract variation, but we don't need to get into all of that detail. But this is the standard uniform of the Civil War soldier. Underneath, I am wearing a contract blouse. This one happens to be red. Many contract blouses would have been made in either a dark brown or a gray. And when I say contract, I mean this is a contract that the US government awarded to a manufacturer to make more stuff. Remember, in 1861, the United States Army was about 16,000 men. George McClellan's gonna bring about 150,000 men down to the Virginia Peninsula in March of 1862. So the federal government has to work overtime to clothe and outfit all of their soldiers, and they're gonna do that by outsourcing a lot of the work, not only to the states, but also to independent contractors. And some of the states are gonna award contracts to independent contractors to make the stuff that the soldiers are gonna wear, and this is why a lot of it in the early war phase ends up being not so good, or what they call shoddy equipment, shoddy clothes, things that fall apart because they're hastily made to try and outfit this massive army that is growing in just a short, very short span of time. So I've got a fatigue blouse, I've got my contract shirt. Beneath my contract shirt, I'm wearing a cotton knit shirt, which would have been more like a privately purchased item or something a soldier would have brought from home. On a cold day like today, it's nice to have that little extra base layer to help keep some warmth in. Standard issue trousers, and beneath that I'm also wearing privately purchased drawers, more like long johns that you might think of today, or long underwear that you might think of today. And then socks came from home. I've got an extra pair of socks. Some of these things would have come from the soldier or from his family, not necessarily from the federal government. So it's a mixture of privately purchased and issued clothing items.
Yeah, a lot of times you'll see the soldiers write home, if you read their letters, talking about some of the shirts that they have that wear like a burlap sack, mm-hmm. feel like a burlap sack. We're not talking sometimes about quality. We're talking about government contractors making it at the lowest bid. It reminds me of Steve Buscemi and Armageddon taking off and his rocket. But that's something that is actually serious. These guys are dealing with these real problems. I mean, when you look on the Confederate side, Robert E. Lee's wife helps to make socks for the soldiers at the front. You have sewing circles in the North and the South trying to make things to keep up with the need. And socks are very, very important. If you read about veterans meeting with green soldiers for the first time, they talk about foot care as being one of the most important things. Make sure you don't wash your feet too early. Why? Because they'll blister. So make sure you wait till you're done. So that's something to always keep in mind as well. So what we're going to do is have Doug gear up for us as we head out into the Remembrance Day Parade. We'll be showing that on YouTube today at 1 o'clock Eastern Time over on the American Battlefield Trust YouTube channel. So Doug, let's time you to see how long this is going to take. Whenever you are ready, sir.
I'm ready now.
And go for it. The official American Battlefield Trust stopwatch, my phone. And so what Doug's doing is he's starting to get everything put together. The backpack is very important to make sure that is going to be put together correctly, because you have to wear that for a long period of time. Sometimes you'll be marching for 10 miles, 12 miles, 30 miles, depending on what unit you're in. So you can notice here he's starting to strap everything together. Basically what you're seeing are leather, very thin pieces of leather that act as laces. They'll be very similar to what he's wearing on his brogans. Those are his shoes. So if you watch the movie Gettysburg and you heard Buster Kilrain say the term, "Oh, my brogans are killing me," what he's talking about is his feet, because his shoes are known as brogans. Doug's putting together on the other side here some straps that has his lantern in it. Also has his wool blanket, which is going to be very important on a day like today. It's not even going to reach 40 degrees here in Gettysburg. It's cool, but it's been worse here in the past for our Remembrance Day coverage. And this is going to be the next part is his shelter half. That's the half of his dog tent that he's rolling up here, getting that all situated. The shelter halves sometimes were of good quality, sometimes of poor quality, made out of canvas. If it's lighter weight canvas, they will come through like a sieve when it rains. So what you want to do is have a heavier canvas, though that is the negative when you're marching if it's a heavier canvas. So he's getting the backpack all strapped together. Sometimes you'll see on the outside or the top of the knapsacks, guys with rolled up blankets, and they'll have your what we call the blanket roll that can go on the top of these backpacks as well. That gives you a little bit of extra space to put more shirts or other things inside of it. Remember, you're carrying about 60 pounds of equipment as you're going off between your gun, as well as your ammunition, backpack, haversack, food that you have. So that is everything that you have to carry. Everything that is going to go down that road has to go on his back. So when you're following along with these armies, many times they will describe, the civilians will describe, and it will look like a a line of men who have gone through and just have thrown things off to the side. So it'll look like a big trash heap as they're going down the road, as they're discarding anything that will save them some weight. Doug, how do you think you're doing?
I think I'm doing okay, actually.
I'm not going to tell him yet, but I'm pretty impressed at the speed so far. So now Doug's working in his haversack. He'll wear this like a large purse or a satchel on his side. This is, as Doug said, a nice to have on the soldier's hip, and he can access this much more easily when he's in the line of march rather than going along with his backpack, which he might have to take off, unstrap, as you saw, and put together. So he's putting all that in there together. And he's got his haversack all put together. Sometimes you'll see guys put on the outside of their haversack their tin cup, kind of hang out there with its strap. So Doug's putting his cartridge box on first. Every Civil War soldier, as we know, is a right-handed soldier. That's a joke, but everything's made for the right-handed person. So he puts his cartridge box on his right hip. He's now going to put on his belt, which is going to help hold down his cartridge box so it doesn't flap around whenever he's running. He could put his haversack on underneath there too to kind of keep that strap down if he choose to. You don't want to put your canteen underneath your belt because that's going to make it more difficult to access. But getting the belt all together, bayonets on the left-hand side, his cartridge box on the right-hand side, as is his cap pouch, which will have that cap of fulminate of mercury, which will help to ignite the gun. So notice it's not as simple as putting on a backpack like you would today. He actually has to put a strap across his chest and then a strap that is gonna hook into the back there of his double-sided, soft-sided backpack. Get that all strapped together. Then, as he has that all put together, pick up his canteen. Very important to have water on the march. And then, of course, his rifle musket. And in 4 minutes and 23 seconds, Doug has put together his marching gear and is ready to go off to battle. So if you would hear the sergeant call first call, that means he's gonna have to start getting all of his stuff together, and then he'll hear the order to fall in, and that would get him ready to march along. Doug, any last thoughts?
Yeah, so what you see here, what I'm wearing as I'm currently outfitted, this would be heavy marching order. Oftentimes for drill or for picket duty or for other things, you will see soldiers told to fall in light marching order, which basically means all of the military equipment, the cap box, the cartridge box, and your canteen. Basically, your ammunition and your water, and that's it. Personally, I don't like to leave my haversack behind, so light marching order for me, unless I'm explicitly told not to, would also include my haversack. And then, you know, as knapsacks are concerned, you'll often see written that soldiers were ordered to put their knapsacks to the side before going into battle. They're ordered to drop packs. There's a reason for this, that is it's easier to maneuver. You know, with the amount of depth I have here, by the book, the man behind me should be, how close, Chris?
13 inches.
Right, so if I now turn to the left, it's very likely I might hit him with my knapsack. So there's that portion of it, and this makes it easier to maneuver. However, I find it hard to believe that the men of Coster's Brigade and the other men of the 11th Corps would have come out here to the Gettysburg Plain without wearing their knapsacks, unless they were told to. Having just lost everything, literally everything, at Chancellorsville, I have a feeling that those guys were probably carrying a little bit more than they needed to when they went into the fight here on July 1st.
Yeah, that's a good point, Doug, because a lot of the guys will be ordered to drop their knapsacks, and if you're pushed off a certain part of the field, then that is just plunder for the Confederates or the Federals, depending on what side you're on. And Doug, Sarah pointed out real fast, the one thing we didn't talk about was your Corps badge.
Yeah, just because I chose to wear my privately purchased Corps badge for the 5th Corps. It's actually one of the first privately purchased Corps badges I ever got. Soldiers were issued these in cloth form or felt form in the spring of 1863. This is one of the ways that Joe Hooker is going to bring esprit de corps to the Army of the Potomac. Each of the 7 corps is going to have its own insignia, 1st through 6th, or 1st through 12th, actually, and then they will continue to wear those throughout the war. And as you will often see them, actually, if you turn this way, Evan, you'll see on the monument to the 154th New York, that crescent moon. That's not just because they liked the moon, it's because the moon or the crescent was the Corps badge of the 11th Army Corps.
So they're going to wear that badge here. You would have seen the men of Coster's division wearing white crescents on their caps or on their blouses, stitched on there in felt. And then as the war goes on, and in the post-war era, these veterans will have privately made badges, often out of metal or even more elaborate materials, to show their pride in their corps. And so that's what this corps badge represents.
Yeah, you'll see it like Joshua Lawrence Chamberlain's house. He has the Maltese cross, the Fifth Corps cross, emblazoned everywhere that you could find. The Soldiers and Sailors Hall in Pittsburgh's that way. You'll see the Maltese cross, others. You have the circle for the First Corps, the trefoil or a clover for Second Corps, diamond for Third, what looks like a triangle for the Fourth, and so on and so forth. And that's the way that Joe Hooker is able to identify his men. They would be red, white, blue, green, orange for 1st through 5th divisions, depending on what division you were in. And that is something that is carryover from the Civil War up to our modern divisional patches in the U.S. Army, the Marine Corps that we have today. So that's a great representation, a great way to close off with our tie into the modern military. So on behalf of the American Battlefield Trust, Doug, thank you so much. We really appreciate you wearing all this stuff. We've walked all the way across the town of Gettysburg to get to this point. We are parked on the other side of town, and Doug carried all of that with him so that we can make this video here on Coster Avenue. Evan Portman behind the camera, Sarah K. Byerly back there as well. I'm Kris White with the American Battlefield Trust. Thank you for watching. Thank you for supporting Battlefield Preservation and Education. And please check out battlefields.org for more of our videos. You can go over to our YouTube channel, American Battlefield Trust, over there on YouTube. And we'll be live today on YouTube at 1 p.m. showing you the Remembrance Day Parade. It is free. And it's 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And so we hope that you'll share this with your friends, with your family, and check out everything we have for free over at battlefields.org, and become a member if you're interested, and help to preserve places like Gettysburg with fellow members of the Trust.